Hello everyone, I'm Norman Wahlberger and welcome to Algebraic Calculus. This is the first of several planned Algebraic Calculus courses. It's running throughout the 2018 year at Open Learning. Here is the URL. And it's an invite-only course, which is meant for, first of all, patrons of my channel. So you can become a patron by going to patreon.com and signing up. And also to mathematics educators at colleges or universities. All we have to do is send me an email at this email here, and I'll register you into the course. So if you don't fall into one of those two categories, well, first of all, you can fall into this category. That's no problem. But if you don't want to, you can wait a year or two, and the course will probably be made public at some point. Okay, so this is the beta version of the course. It's in preparation. We are developing it as we go. We're only going to be releasing parts of the course at a time. So because it's a lot of work to put it together. But I want to tell you a little bit about the course. It's very exciting. I'm really excited about it. And I think it'll be really fun. And it'll be, I think, a really new aspect of modern mathematics education. And in fact, modern mathematics as well. The main organization of the course is into chapters. And there are 12 chapters. And they're going to be released in the 12 months of 2018. The course is actually aimed for a one-semester course at the university level, in which case each chapter would correspond to a week. So it's designed for a 12-week semester. And let's go through the chapters, just to give you a sense of the topics that we're going to be introducing. So the first one is the affine plane, and then we're going to talk about signed areas, oriented splines, sums of powers, curves and motion, some topology and physics, and we introduce tangents, the discrete calculus, signed integrals, logarithms and exponentials, integration techniques, and applications of integration. So it's pretty fair to say that the course is more oriented towards the integral calculus than it is towards the differential calculus. And of course, this is not an all-embracing list of topics. There are going to be more topics in the subsequent algebraic calculus courses that I'm planning. So what we're going to do is we're going to have these chapters become available month by month. So in January, you're going to get the affine plane, and then in February, signed areas, and so on. So the chapters are going to open up sequentially. And some of them are still in development, so you know it's possible there might be a little bit of movement around here. Nothing is set in stone at this stage, but this is the overall general plan at this stage. So each chapter is going to consist of four modules. So for example, the first chapter, the affine plane, will contain the four modules, points and lines affine, points and lines projective, vectors and displacement, and centers of mass and Archimedes. Four modules belonging to one chapter. And I'm guessing that each module requires about 3 hours of work at the very least. That's kind of a minimum. So altogether, we can expect a minimum of around 12 hours of work to go through a chapter. But for some of you, it will be more than that. You'll have to work harder because your background may not be, you know, up to the level of others. So there's some variation there, but I think roughly 12 hours of work per chapter is reasonable. So the material in a module is always organized in the same way, into four sections. The first section contains a video and notes. The notes, a summary of the video, plus perhaps a little bit of extra information. Then there are worked problems, and the problems are typically organized this way. P stands for problem, and then 1.1.5. That means it's chapter 1, module 1, and problem 5 in that module. And there's a little icon here. This little icon signifies worked problems. Then there's homework questions section. Homework questions denoted by Q, also labeled in the same way. Chapter, module, and then the question number. And the icon for that is a little paper with a pencil. And the final section, links, definitions, and formulas, which is sort of self-explanatory, and the icon for that is this double arrow here. So the worked problems and the homework questions are perhaps the heart of the matter. We're going to really delve into a lot of different aspects of the course and get you working. But the word problems is basically us telling you how to solve various interesting problems. And they all have solutions which are hidden until you click to view. So the problem will be there, but you won't actually see the solution until you click the click to view, and then you'll see it, giving you a chance to have a go at solving the problem yourself before you look at the solution. But looking at the solution is easy enough. The questions, the homework questions, will also have answers typically, but the answers will just be short, not elaborate solutions. So that's really where I'm expecting you to put in some work. So this is the structure for each of the modules. The course is designed for a broad spectrum of people. Primarily, of course, we're talking about first-year college and university students. That's sort of the main cohort that we're aiming at. Students coming into university who want to learn mathematics really solidly and correctly, and who want to really enrich their understanding of modern pure mathematics. So they're really requiring a strong background and ability in maths. Okay, so a really good high school student, done really well in maths, strong ability, strong interest in it, we're aiming for them. Also math majors, any mathematics major at a university or college is going to be interested in this course. Graduate students, not just in maths, but also physics or engineering, will find it very interesting and hopefully enlightening. Mathematical educators, of course, I hope that teachers and professors around various colleges in the world will start thinking about this as a viable alternative to the current status quo. And finally, but not least, the general public. People who just have an interest in pure mathematics, and of course some ability and some strong motivation to work hard and study and learn lots of interesting things. So naturally enough, this course is going to be very different from most calculus courses on the planet. But I just want to orient you more specifically to what to expect. So some key orientation here. The first is that no prior assumptions about the meanings of critical or fundamental terms is going to be invoked. We are not going to assume that you have prior complete understanding of terms such as number, function, curve, area, set, point, line, circle, tangent, sequence, polynomial, variable. It's not going to be the case that I'm going to assume that you know what that means. We are going to acknowledge that we all have a rough idea of most of these terms, because a lot of them really come from everyday English usage, after all. But our aim is going to be to move towards having precise and clear definitions of these terms. And that might involve being a little bit more restrictive. Instead of having a broad understanding of, you know, what a number is in some great generality, maybe we're going to have to be satisfied with knowing what, you know, a special class of numbers is. These numbers over here, and then maybe these numbers over here, and these numbers over here. So we're thinking about building up our understanding small to large, rather than embracing everything all at once at the beginning. Okay, so that's going to be an aspect. But it's really important that we're not assuming that you know what a function is, or a sequence, or even area. Okay? We are going to work towards pinning those things down. And this is a huge difference between this course and its orientation and pretty well every other calculus course on the planet, and maybe even in history. Okay? We are going to be very fussy and concerned about these things. We're always going to have our eye on what do these words really, really precisely, correctly mean? Can we nail them down? And our second orientation is that we are not going to allow ourselves to pretend that we can do an infinite number of things. From my point of view, we cannot do an infinite number of things, and we're not going to pretend that we can. In other words, computer programs are not run to infinity. We do not have a model in our mind of here's a computer, and it's got a program loaded, we press the run button, and then we wait for all eternity. And this computer is generating more and more stuff, and eventually the stuff overwhelms the known universe, but still we're thinking about it. And the computer program runs to infinity, and at the end of that infinity, lo and behold, we have an output, and we start talking about the output. Look, here's the output of this computer program that we've just run to infinity. Okay, this is nonsense as far as I'm concerned, and we are not going to do this. Now, this is actually something that's done so often in modern pure mathematics, it's actually very sad. But it means, very particularly, that there's a lot of standard stuff which is written down which will not be accessible to us, at least not initially, not directly, not in the standard way. For example, cosine 5. Cosine 5, you actually think about it and analyze it and work out what it is. It's actually the result of a computer program being run and the output collected after an infinite amount of time. We are not going to allow that. So this thing is not an exact object for us. Of course, we can talk about pressing the program and letting it run for 3 minutes and then stopping it and then taking whatever we have and then considering that to be cosine of 5. In that sense, these kinds of things may have some approximate meaning, but as for exact meanings, no, we're not going to allow it. Pi, sorry, log 10, no. Square root of 37, no. E, no. 5 to the third, no. Arctan of 0.13, no. Even something like this, which is seemingly, you know, not so problematic, 0.3333, etc. Even that is going to be problematic for us because we don't have a prior theory of periodic repeating decimals in place. So if we're imagining that we're having an infinite number of digits here that we're adding up, some cumulative thing, we're really falling into this situation here of pretending that we're doing an infinite number of things. So we're not going to do that. So we're going to be very wary even about something like this. And what about something like this, 10 to the 10 to the 10 to the, up to the 10, where they say 1,000 tens in that tower? Well, maybe that's not quite an infinite number of things, but it's still such a large number of things going far beyond the bounds of the universe that we're going to be very skeptical about even such things. So our skepticism does not restrict itself to just infinite things, but also to very large things. Once things get very large, we start getting nervous and we start thinking, we need to hedge our bets, we need to retreat, we need to find safer ground. All right, so that's our general orientation, practical, rooted on solid reality and real life, okay? What computers can really do. Computers are our friends, okay? We are wanting to march in parallel with our computer friends. And our third general orientation is that we really value concrete computations and explicit examples. These are things that we love and that we aim for. And they're especially important when you're learning a subject, to really be able to see explicit examples, which are not trivial, which are representative of the theory they're supposedly demonstrating, and also to be able to compute. We're very interested in being able to compute. Calculus is all about computation. So we aim to be mathematical scientists, not philosophers, if I may put it that way. Okay? We want to be scientists, and a mathematician makes computations in the same way that a scientist makes observations. Without observations, science is very weak. Similarly, without computations and without explicit examples, mathematics turns out to be very weak as well. We're trying to make it solid. This is a way of grounding us by looking at these things. So we're going to have a lot of fun, all right? And I'm sure that there'll be all kinds of interesting things happening. Don't really know how it'll turn out, but I'm sure it'll be fun. So I'm hoping that a lot of you will join us. It doesn't have to be at the beginning of the year. We have lots of time. The course will unfold in a leisurely way. So join us whenever you can. And if you can't join the course, well, you can always watch at least most of the videos on my sister channel, Wild Egg Mathematics Courses, which is on YouTube, of course. All right, so I'm going to post the videos, at least a lot of them, there. So I'm hoping you're going to join me. There's lots to do, there's lots to learn, and I hope we'll have some fun. I'm Norman Wahlberger. Thanks for listening.